Hello, Phyllis. How you doing? This is Richard Santiago. I believe I have a meeting today with the postmaster.
Yeah, we have to reschedule and she's off this week.
Oh, okay. No problem. What day
would
be good for?
So did we have you down for today? Let me check. I thought we rescheduled you. Did we reschedule you?
Well, this is the second reschedule.
Okay. She's on annual, so...
Okay.
She's on vacation, so that's the reason.
I thought
we rescheduled you for, let's see.
Well, we had it set, I believe, for like July, sometime in July. I think I would say July 14th. And when I called, we rescheduled for today.
Okay, so maybe I meant it for the 25th.
No problem.
Let me check.
Thank you very much.
And it was supposed to be at what time?
It was 9 that you set up. 9 o'clock.
Okay,
was the time.
So. Well, you want to do 9 on Tuesday the 25th? Oh, you know what it was? She said she wouldn't be able to meet with you today because she was on annual leave.
Okay.
And I don't remember if I called you or left a voice message or something, because I remember her telling me that she was not going to be here this week.
Okay.
Maybe I forgot to call you because I thought I changed it.
That's quite all right. Not a problem.
Hold on a second. Hold on.
Sure.
Let's try the 25th at 9 o'clock.
Okay.
See if she said she can't do it, but I'm
going to
put it in.
Okay.
And we'll do
Tuesday at 9.
Sounds great. Okay. Tuesday at 9. Give me your phone number in case something changes.
Sure thing. It is 413.
What is it?
413.
Uh-huh.
370.
Mm-hmm.
2400.
2400?
That's correct, yes.
Okay, I'll put it down and see if she says she's not going to be able to do it. But I'll put it in here, and if something changes, I'll call you.
Thank you very much, Phyllis.
Right.
I appreciate your help.
Oh, no problem.
All right, enjoy the rest of the week. Yes, you too.
Bye-bye now.
Goodbye. Okay, so... are they going to continue to just reschedule and reschedule and reschedule? This is the second time that they're rescheduling. As I said, the first time, I believe, was, I want to say July 14th, where we had it scheduled. They did call. They did call and tell me that the 14th was, or whatever date it was not good for them. I didn't see that until... I didn't get the message until the actual like an hour before we were calling. So I did call her just to let her know that I received her message and if we could reschedule. And we rescheduled for today, the 18th, at 9 o'clock. And apparently she is on annual, which is what we call vacation. She's on vacation, so she couldn't make it. She said she called. I'm going to give her the benefit of the doubt that she did call me, because she's, now that we've set some type of understanding between each other that I am filming, she's kind of acting right. And you can see that in another video that I made. I'll put the link in the description. So I would say, yeah, she called or she made the attempt and I just never received the message, but this still comes down to, are they on Tuesday the 25th, are they going to tell me, oh, we had to reschedule? Is this going to be the ongoing thing? We have to reschedule. Just, to bring you all up to par, I was on vacation from maybe like the 14th to, August 3rd, and while I was on, before I was on vacation, They gave me a series of investigative interviews. For those of you that don't know what an investigative interview is, it's Q&A was the best thing I can think of, where the supervisor asks you a series of questions, and based on that series of questions, they determine on whether discipline should be given to the person who is being questioned. Well, every day up until I went on vacation, every day they gave me an investigative interview for some things valid, some things not. Let's just put it that way. And so while I was on vacation, they took it upon themselves to issue me a suspension and a letter of warning. Now, for those of you that don't know, when usually it might be different between unions, but usually when you receive a letter of warning, when you have a union or a suspension, you have 14 days to fight it and to grieve it. And so by them giving me my suspension, knowing that I have a 3-week vacation, giving it to me in the beginning of the week, they know that, well, be honest, they don't know if I'm having a home vacation where I'm staying at home, or they don't know what I'm doing. My particular thing, no, we were in LA for a week, we were in Mexico for 4 days, and then I was in Japan for probably 2 weeks. So my thing is, this was all planned, and they were hoping that I would be on a vacation away from home to where they can they can send me through the mail my suspension, and I can't grieve it. 14 days are up, and then, you know, now the suspension and the letter of warning stay on my record. And to me, that's what they were hoping for and they were going for. I think that this should be thrown out just totally based on the way they tried to handle it. First of all, they went for a suspension for something that I did for the first time. My first time offense, I should say, is a better way to put it. First time offense, they went for suspension. No, it's it's verbal warning first, then it's letter of warning, and then it's a suspension. And sometimes some people do 2 letters of warning. So I have to do the offense 4 times, 3 or 4 times, before I can receive a suspension. No, they went straight for suspension, which proves that this is punitive and not corrective. They're not trying to correct my behavior. They're trying to give me punishment because it's retaliation. And for those of you that haven't been following, back in, I believe, May of 2015, I met this supervisor, and I'm not afraid to say her name. Her name is Monique Treadwell. And what had happened is I was awaiting surgery. My doctor told me, go back to work. While you await your surgery, it's going to be 30 days for the surgery. Go back to work on light duty. She didn't want to work me light duty. She wanted me to go out to the street and deliver my route in 20-pound increments because the doctor said don't lift more than 20 pounds. When I told her that that's not a good idea, she began to yell at me and to bully me. And that's what the post office does. They bully you so that you say, okay, I'll go do my route. No, you got the wrong guy. You do that to somebody else, it's not gonna work with me. So when she started to scream and yell, I right away called the postmaster, set up a meeting with the postmaster. This is the second time I've done this, set meetings up with the postmaster. This would be the third postmaster that I set a meeting up with after I see this one. I set a meeting up with the postmaster, and I told him that she's abusive, she screams and she yells. I told him everything. Then I filed some paperwork on that. And when I did that, she had to go back for retraining, because the post office, of course, has to show, oh, we're trying our best to retrain these supervisors, but they don't hold them accountable. To me, if you've been to training once, that should be your verbal warning, just like anything else. That's your verbal warning. You go twice, that should be a letter of warning. And you go again, if another worker or the same worker reports you, then you should be suspended. That's how it should work in my book. But there's no accountability. They just go to these trainings. And the funny thing is, the postmaster told me she went for retraining. She told everybody else that they needed her at another station, Crossroads, here in Las Vegas. And they needed her there, and that's where she went. Did the postmaster lie to me, or is she lying to us? Don't know. But the point is that there's no accountability, and that's why these people do this. And if you remember, I'm going to say this over and over again. If you remember in the late 80s and early 90s, all the postal shootings, that there's a phrase for people who go crazy, right? It's called don't go postal, or, you know, going postal. That occurred because these people were treated the same way that I'm treated. The way that I'm being treated right now with the fake investigative interviews and the fake suspensions and going and on first offenses going for suspensions rather than going for verbal warnings. This is what led those people to do that. Thank God that I have this outlet of my film crew here that I have, and the ability to make films, that I have an outlet to this. Those people didn't have an outlet, and that's the outlet they chose. And the United States Postal Service is not protecting the American people, because a customer could get shot during one of these mass shootings. They're not protecting the other employees, and they have an obligation to give us a violent free workplace, free from shootings, free from supervisors who scream and yell, free from all that, and they're not doing that. And this is the story that needs to be told. And I'm looking for the writer, the news reporter, anybody who has the power in the media to tell this story. I'm not going to call out their names, but I wrote to so many people in Las Vegas who call themselves investigative reporters, tell them about the story, show them my evidence, because as you know, I'm filming my day-to-day, I'm doing audio recordings of my day-to-day day-to-day functions at work, my day-to-day experiences. And I show them all this. I show them the bullying by the president of the local union here in Las Vegas, and he doesn't want to do a story on it. Why? Because it's a cash cow. The United States Postal Service is a cash cow for these newspapers and news organizations, and they'll lose revenue if they do a story like this, and that's why they're not doing it. And I'm looking and I'm searching. I know you're out there. Whoever you are, give me a call. 413-370-2400. Call me. This story needs to be told before one more person dies, before there's one more mass shooting in the Postal Service. Call me. Leave your comments below. And please don't forget to subscribe to this channel so you can keep up with what's happening with me. Thank you very much for watching, and enjoy the rest of your week.